do want to participate actually sipping from the cup, I just ask you to wait till the end so you can, so I can make sure that everyone else who isn't there yet or will ever be there can commune in safety of conscience, in good conscience. Okay? I emphasize that. You want a good conscience when you're communing the elements. All right? Now, let us prepare our hearts, minds, and bodies to come into an encounter with God in the event of faith by the power of the Holy Spirit through the proclamation of Christ in word and song in communion.
Thank you.
Blessed be the one holy and living God. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. God be with you. Let us pray. O God, the protector of all who trust in you, without whom nothing is strong, nothing is holy, increase and multiply upon us your mercy, that with you as our ruler and guide, we may so pass through things temporal that we lose not the things eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Please be seated and prepare for the readings.
Our first reading is from Genesis. Laban said to Jacob, "Because you are my kinsman, should you therefore serve me for nothing? Tell me, what shall your wages be?" Now Laban had two daughters. The name of the elder was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. Leah's eyes were lovely, and Rachel was graceful and beautiful. Jacob loved Rachel, so he said, "I will serve you 7 years for your younger daughter, Rachel." Laban said, "It is better that I give her to you than that I should give her to any other man. Stay with me." So Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and they seemed to him but a few days because of the love he had for her. Then Jacob said to Laban, "Give me my wife that I may go in to her, for my time is completed." So Laban gathered together all the people of the place and made a feast. But in the evening he took his daughter Leah and brought her to Jacob, and he went in to her. Laban gave his maid Zilpah to his daughter Leah to be her maid. When morning came, it was Leah, and Jacob said to Laban, "What is this you have done to me? Did I not serve with you for Rachel? Why then have you deceived me?" Laban said, "This is not done in our country, giving the younger before the firstborn. Complete the week of this one, and we will give you the other also in return for serving me another 7 years." Jacob did so and completed her week. Then Laban gave him his daughter Rachel as a wife. Remember the marvels God has done. The next reading will be from Psalms, and respond in half verse. Give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Sing to him, sing praises to him. Glory in his holy name. Search for the Lord in his strength. Remember the marvels he has done. O offspring of Abraham, his servant. He is the Lord our God. He has always been mindful of his covenant. The covenant he made with Abraham, which he established as a statute for Jacob, saying, to you will I give the land of Canaan. Hallelujah. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people. The Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for all saints according to the will of God. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn within a large family. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own Son, but gave him up for all of us, he will not with him also give us everything else. Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or prosecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are counted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Another parable Jesus put before the crowds. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all the seeds, but when it has grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all of it was leavened. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets, but threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all this? They answered, yes. And he said to them, therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. The gospel of the Lord. Please pray with me. Give thanks to God and call upon God's name. Make known God's deeds among the peoples. Sing to God, sing praises to God, and speak of all God's marvelous works. Glory in God's holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek God rejoice. Amen. Please be seated. So far in chapter 8 of Romans, we've covered a few things, okay? Now, remember that we have skipped through a bunch of chapters, like we did to chapter 4, chapter 5, chapter all of chapter 6, a little bit of chapter 7, all of chapter 8. When the lectionary tells us to spend time in one chapter, usually there's a reason, okay? So we spend time in that chapter, but I just want to refresh your minds. Okay, I know all of you take copious notes and go home and study every Sunday afternoon and listen to me say it all over again via the website, but just in case, for the one person who doesn't do that, I'll go ahead and remind you what we've covered so far in just Romans 8, okay? So first, Romans 8, 1 through 11. We started the chapter learning, so then at this very time, there is not one punishment following condemnation for those in Christ Jesus. Romans 8, 1. This is the controlling thought for the chapter, right? Those who love God because they have been loved by God need not fear the law and its ability to condemn because they trust God by faith and love God. Okay? Remember, to love God is the point, okay? That is bare minimum the point of God's relationship with God's people is to get God's people to love God, all right? Okay, so the law is exposed as weak by our inability to do it because it only tells us do this and don't do that, but it cannot cause us to do the thing. Does a speed limit sign ever run after you and smack itself against your car when you're going too fast? No, it doesn't. If it does, we need to talk. All right? Because sounds like you might be on something fun. So the law says drive 25. Now it's your responsibility to drive 25 or not drive 25, right? It can only tell you to do this or don't do that. It can't make you do it. All right? So the law is exposed as weak because it can't actually get you to obedience. Does that make sense? Okay. All right. So also we found out in regards to the law on Good Friday, a very important thing, which is that we broke the law by listening, by not listening and loving Christ, God incarnate, and by forcing the law to condemn an innocent man. So when I use the term broke the law, I mean broke in two ways. I mean, we didn't love God or our neighbor, Jesus. Remember, Jesus is the culmination, not only of the spoken and acting out of the two great commandments, to love God and to love your neighbor, but Jesus literally, according to the biblical witness, is God, is the neighbor, because he's enfleshed, right? Isn't that mind-boggling? So when we sentence Jesus to the cross and we release the wonderful Barabbas into the world, we sentenced our neighbor and God to the cross. That's the profoundness of what happens on Good Friday. So we broke the law. We didn't love God. We didn't love our neighbor. But then we also broke the law because in our judgment according to the flesh, we forced the law to condemn an innocent person. Whenever you're bent on the flesh, you will end up with death, right? That's what Paul says, okay? So here, Paul told us, when we're dead set on living according to the flesh, then we will judge according to the flesh. Then Paul is quick to usher us out of our tombs into Easter. Paul, notice, Paul never leaves us dead and condemned. Always within paragraphs, you get both exposure and comfort. So Paul ushers us quickly into Easter life by reminding us that Pentecost happened and God's Spirit is in us. Thus we walk not according to the judgment of the flesh, but according to the conviction of the Spirit. Okay? This is going to change how we step in the world. It's going to make our bodily presence in the world a whole bunch different. Okay? So effectually, Paul reminds us that even though we sentenced Jesus because we were stuck in the flesh, God's love, this is Easter, God's love knows no limits and cannot be hindered, not even by death. And in Christ's resurrection, God demonstrates that God's love is always and forever, and we are exposed. But the twist is that in our exposure, we are not shoved out to the outer limits of darkness, to the wailing and gnashing of teeth, but rather we are exposed, and that big divine loving arm comes in and sweeps us deeper and further into God. Okay? That's amazing. We are exposed and ushered into God's presence and accepted, even though, in spite of. Okay, this is true love, mercy, and grace, right? We didn't get what, remember, mercy is not getting what you deserve to get. You get pulled over and the cop lets you go, right? That's mercy. Grace is getting that which you did not deserve, meaning you took all the markers out of the marker box, scribbled all over the walls everywhere, ripped all the sheets off your bed, cut holes in all your stuffed animals, and mom gave you dessert after dinner. That's grace, right? You actually didn't have a lack of something. You actually got something that was beyond what you deserve. That's grace, okay? And all of this is love. Then in 8:12-25, all right, so you're moving right through Romans, Paul builds up the mercy, grace, and love of God for us and exhorted us to live into our adoption as children of God by faith in Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, so that we live in the world, okay? We're not up and out of the world as Christians. We are down and into the world like Christ was, right? And we live in that world, in the temporal realm. Our colic today talked about the temporal and the eternal, okay? We need to live into the temporal realm, the material realm, as material girls, okay? Some of you know Madonna, right? Fantastic theologian, okay? But, so we do this as God's beloved children. Paul drew the line in the sand, for if you are living according to the flesh, you intend to die. But if you are living according to the Spirit, you are putting to death the deeds of the body, you will live. Remember, this is not about now reverting to the law and living according to condemnation, fear, threat, and self-induced purity and piety. That is a returning to the spirit of slavery brought again into fear. Remember, Romans 4, I'm sure you all remember Romans 4 and the sermon therein, right? Is all about how dealing with sin isn't about turning further in and trying to like do it right by the law, but in shrugging off that need and entering into God, thus entering in towards the neighbor, right? That's how we contend with our outward bodies, okay? So you, Paul says, reminding us faithfully that you received a spirit of adoption by which we cry aloud, Abba, elder, or Abba, father, or Abba, mother, whatever word works there for you that brings you the most comfort, okay? Returning to a life where you're in service to the law will enslave you to fear and condemnation. It will deny liberation, which is the product of God's love and life in you, given by God's grace and mercy. Okay, so Paul is not exhorting you to turn in and focus on your sins, your own personal sins, okay? Rather, you are to focus on the things of life, love, and liberation. Okay, so you go from this posture, curved in, you're uprighted. And once you're uprighted, your eyes can look horizontally and see your neighbor, and you can love on your neighbor. But if you're turned in on yourself, trying to combat a whole bunch of privatized sins because you're worried about your relationship with God, you're not serving God, you're serving the law, and now you're also not serving your neighbor because you're too curved in to do so, right? So you need to be curved upright to help your neighbor. All right. So Paul explains, if we return to the law in fear, we will not run to God, but away from God. Rather, we're to run to God, cry out for Abba, and have hope, because hope is a byproduct of love. That's Romans 8, 12 to 25, okay? It's all of it's filtering through, and Paul is giving you more and more reason to be completely different in the world because of this wonderful, beautiful relationship with God. So Paul says further, okay, in Romans 8, 26 to 39. Now I warn you, the Greek was difficult to kind of translate, so it might sound a little bit choppy because I'm not an expert translation person, okay? But just bear with it. Listen to this. Now, in like manner, writes Paul, the Spirit takes hold with us in our weakness, for we do not perceive what we should pray according to what is necessary, but the same Spirit intercedes for inexpressible groaning. Now, we perceive that all things work together toward good for the ones who love God, who are being called according to God's purpose. Therefore, what will we speak to these things? If God is on our behalf, who is against us? God, who spared not God's own Son, but committed him on our behalf, how is it absolutely out of the question that also with him, God will give freely all things to us? In all these things, we prevail mightily through the one who loved us. Okay, Romans 8, 26, 28, 31 to 32, and 37. I collapsed it. All right. So what is Paul saying here? Okay, building from the discussion on God's love for us and our love for God, provoking hope that motivates us now, Paul speaks to the Spirit helping us to pray in our weakness, which is that weakness is not perceiving how to pray rightly. I am sure I am the only one here who has ever had a moment where I did not know what to pray. Do you know we have a whole entire prayer book dedicated to giving you words when you don't know how to pray? Right? But even when you lack words, sometimes we pray something, and in our weakness, we are praying for this thing, and the Spirit sort of goes, interesting, I hear you, I see you, I love you. I'm just going to take these words and rearrange all the letters, and then they're going to be this prayer for God's will to be done on earth, right? So we have this freedom to pray as we're going to, or maybe even to be silent, and the Spirit intercepts, comes in, and reformulates the prayers, and they enter into the throne room, okay, through the Spirit. So even if you pray clumsily, maybe even if you pray selfishly, God can intervene through the Spirit and take those prayers and turn it into a failed experiment making a cake into a beautiful, beautiful, wonderful cake, okay? So The Spirit intercedes. In other words, we pray and the Spirit takes those sounds and words, the inexpressible groaning, and molds them into prayers coinciding with the Spirit of God, the same one who searches the heart and mind of the beloved. This is what Paul is saying. Do you remember Charlie Brown and the parents' voices in the background? And then the kids would be like, okay. You know, but like, I didn't really get that necessarily until I became an adult. And then I understood what those want was, right? I actually could translate it in my head because I had said all the want was having three kids. All right. So I imagine that when we pray in our weakness, it can often sound quite muffled, like a want. And the Spirit's like, I got you here, and then makes it completely articulate and clear. Okay. So, to pray according to Paul is to speak to God in alignment with the Spirit of God. This means an exposure and realignment to God in God's Spirit. When we pray, we dare to allow God to shape our words and our hearts to reflect God's love, life, and liberation, no matter what we pray for. You come in, bend the knee, and pray for something that you desperately need. And as you're praying, this encounter with God occurs, and you might even hear those words start to change. You are formed in prayer. You don't have to come into prayer formed. We come sometimes discombobulated and rather confused, and we just start praying, and then all of a sudden, that Spirit, that verbal Spirit enters in, and we are aligning our words with God. Okay? In this way, as we pray, we find ourselves in the realm of the proclamation of Christ. We are exposed and accepted and brought further into God's mercy and grace. Why do we pray? Because we want all of that. Okay? We want that forming. Thus, we begin to pray aligned to Christ's self-witness. This is not about bombarding the door of the divine throne room with incessant, heartless repetition of words. Rather, it's about finding yourself before God, praying for God's will to be done on earth as it is in heaven, and advocating for the neighbor. We move from praying for ourselves to praying for our neighbor. And I need to tell you this, when you pray for your neighbor, guess who you're also praying for? Yourself. Okay? Remember, when you liberate your neighbor from oppression, you actually liberate yourself. Okay? So we find ourselves in this moment being formed and in this realm of divine reception. Okay, when we're aligned to Christ, the Spirit takes hold of our desires and wishes and forms them in accordance with the will of God. Divinely twisted prayers, seeking and searching for life, love, and liberation for the entire cosmos. Okay, prayer is a form of proclamation, and proclamation always exposes and always comforts. Okay, so we enter into that when we pray. Next, Paul dares to say, all things work together for good for those who love God. And if there is ever a line from Romans that has been more manipulated and abused, it's that one, right? Often understood as, I have faith, so my life is going to go well. I have faith, so I will be wealthy and rich. I want to start this endeavor, and by faith, God is with me, and I will achieve this endeavor. My sports team will win, right? Okay? I hate to say this. That line is not about any of that stuff, okay? But when it's extracted, we call that eisegesis. When it's taken out and we read something into it that we want, it becomes a very violent tool. Rather, if you actually leave it in context of Romans 8, it's fantastic and even more beautiful than using it as a tool to benefit yourself, okay? This is about God's word of life, love, and liberation as the absolute last word, the absolute good. All things work toward good for those who love God. What is the good according to God? Life, love, and liberation. This is what Jesus came to do, to go to the fringes, heal people, touch them, liberate them, forgive them, set them on their way, bring them back in. It's not about cars or houses or any of that stuff, or having like the biggest plan or the most of this or the most famous existence or being the biggest influencer. No, that's not the good. The good is life, love, and liberation. Always, always. Because where those things are, there you get to be, and that is good. Okay? So, conjoined to what came before, the Spirit taking hold with us in our weakness and forming our prayers because we lack perception, we then gain the perception that every little action reaching toward life, love, and liberation, even when things are a massive dumpster fire, and they can be, I don't think I'm the only one who sometimes has that perception, okay? We'll work toward good, toward love, life, and liberation. And here we have hope to see that all things are possible with God, right? That was last week. All things are possible with God. That's the hope. So even if the smallest thing, the tiniest meal, or the hello, how are you on the street, if it makes someone feel seen, heard, and loved, that's the good. It's not about you. It's about that person. But then being about that person, it's about you. Okay? So then, Paul moves on to say, affirming all things, working together for those who love God. If God is on our behalf, who is against us? If God is the author of love, life, and liberation in general, and specifically, even when God committed God's Son on our behalf, and we responded with the judgment according to the flesh, which led to the death of God's Son, then who or what can be against us? Who is bigger than God? If God did not turn God's back on us after we sentenced God's Son to the cross, killed him dead, poked him, made sure everything dead, God did not reject us. God resurrected Jesus. God said, I still love you, you little jerks. Okay? Right? So who is bigger than God? If God loves us even still, tell me who is bigger that can eclipse that. What is more powerful than love? Hate? No, because hate gives way to love because it's made of the same stuff. Okay? Indifference? No, because indifference's power is only about consuming. And love wins over indifference every time. Love can enter into that negative space of indifference and fill it with itself. And there love is, right? So nothing's better than love, right? What is bigger than life? Death? No! Easter happened. God demonstrated that not even death can conquer life. What is more profound than liberation? Nothing, because not even a bit of captivity will ever let you be you. Fully and wonderfully you, the beautiful you that you are. Okay? So if God is the source of life, love, and liberation, and God is on our behalf, and we're on God's behalf, then should we return to a spirit of fear? You can answer. No, right? Should we then return to the law to find our justification with God? I'll give you a clue. No, I'm leading the witness. Okay, no, why would you return to the law when the whole entire thing is done just by loving God? Don't worship the law, use the law to benefit your neighbor, okay? Should we then intentionally miss the mark just because Paul asked earlier in Romans 8? No, why would we do that? That could hurt our neighbor, okay? Should we perpetuate death and destruction as if we're saved from hell and that is all that matters? No, because people are dying. Our neighbors are hurting, right? Should we roll over and declare everything impossible? Meganoito, to quote Paul. Ah, heck no. Absolutely not. Anything is possible with God. Herein does the good find its way. Cutting through the muck and mire of human deed, humans dead set on the flesh and death. Okay? God's love can pierce and penetrate anything. Okay? All right, to conclude, beloved, we're exhorted by Paul in the entirety of Romans 8 to press into the divine life that is with us, among us, and in us. We're exhorted to live as those who trust God, who dare to trust God, as those who are inspired by the divine spirit, as those who have been forgiven and who forgive, as those who can carry God's mercy and grace forward into the world. We're to pray as we're led to pray, asking for God's will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. And knowing that when we pray, the Spirit intercedes for us, molding and shaping our hearts, minds, and bodies in accordance with that will. We do not need to pray perfectly or repetitively, only simply. Okay? In this, as we move about the world, we become those who can bring God close to those who are pushed off, rejected, declared unlovable, those still held hostage and captive by unjust systems and structures. We get to be the ones who declare by word and deed God's life, love, and liberation, to represent Christ into the world today, now, to participate in the fracturing of the stagnant. This is all there is. And resisting lethargy and declaring confidently and defiantly to a world set on death and fear, no, there is more here than meets the eye. Every time, every day, there is more here than meets the eye. For all things are possible with God, who works all things together for good of all the beloved, whom God loves. Romans 8. Those who have ears to hear, let them hear. In whatever posture you find most comfortable, and if you feel so led, please join with me with the affirmation of reciting the affirmation of faith, located on the screens in front of you. We believe in God above us, maker and sustainer of all life, of sun and moon, of water and earth, of all living things. We believe in God beside us, Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh, born of a woman, servant of the poor, tortured and nailed to a tree, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. He died forsaken. He descended into the earth, to the place of death. On the third day, he rose from the tomb. He ascended into heaven to be everywhere present, and his kingdom will come on earth. We believe in God within us, the Holy Spirit burning with Pentecostal fire, life-giving breath of the church, Spirit of healing and forgiveness, source of resurrection and of eternal life. Amen. Again, in whatever posture you find most comfortable, and if you feel so called, join with us in the prayers of the people. In peace, we pray, Lord God, for our community, the church, and the world. Creator, we pray for unity within the Church of God and between all traditions. Grant that all who know you by any name may truly and humbly serve you and their neighbor. We pray for all bishops, priests, deacons, and leaders in all traditions. We pray especially for our leadership team. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in all the communities, states, regions, and nations of the world. Give each of us gathered here grace, strength, and courage to be examples of your love in all that we do. May our care for this world, our island home, show the gratitude and respect given by welcome guests. Have compassion on all your people, especially those who are suffering from grief or troubles. Give to our beloved departed, especially Charlie Hudson, eternal rest. Let us pray out loud or in silence for our own needs and those of others. Grant us these blessings, O Lord. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I give to you, my own peace I leave with you. Regard not our sins, but the faith of your church, and give us the peace and unity of that heavenly city, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, now and forever.
Amen."
Let us confess our sins to God. God of all mercy, we confess that we have sinned against you, opposing your will in our lives. We have denied your forgiveness in each other, in ourselves, and in the world we have created. We repent of the evil that enslaves us, the evil we have done, and the evil done on our behalf. Forgive, restore, and strengthen us. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through the grace of Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in your life. The peace of Christ. And now the peace of Christ is with you all.
And also with you.
Okay. You guys could hear me though, right? Okay. I take my Greek heritage very seriously, so I like to have a nice big booming voice. Okay, let's just do the offertory sentence. Why delay it? Let us with gladness present the offerings and oblations of our life and labor to the Lord. All things come of you, O God. This is God's table for God's people. All who feel called to come forward are not only invited, but are especially encouraged to do so. God be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to our God. It is truly right and good and joyful to give you thanks, all holy God, source of life and fountain of mercy. You have filled us and all creation with your blessing and fed us with your constant love. You have redeemed us in Jesus Christ and knit us into one body. Through your Spirit, you replenish us and call us to the fullness of life. Therefore, joining with angels and archangels and with faithful of every generation, we lift our voices with all creation as we sing. Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of the universe and giver of life. You formed us in your own image and called us to dwell in your infinite love. You gave the world into our care that we might be your faithful stewards and show forth your bountiful grace. But we failed to honor your image in one another and in ourselves. We would not see your goodness in the world around us. And so we violated your creation, abused one another, and rejected your love. Yet you never ceased to care for us and prepared the way of salvation for all people. Through Abraham and Sarah, you called us into covenant with you. You delivered us from slavery, sustained us in the wilderness, and raised up prophets to renew your promise of salvation. Then, in the fullness of time, you sent your eternal word, made mortal flesh in Jesus, born into the human family and dwelling among us. He revealed your glory. Giving himself freely to death on the cross, he triumphed over evil, opening the way of freedom and life. On the night before he died for us, our Savior Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." As the supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Remembering his death and resurrection, we now present to you from your creation this bread and this wine. By your Holy Spirit, may they be for us the body and blood of your Savior Jesus Christ. Grant that we who share these gifts may be filled with the Holy Spirit and live as Christ's body in the world. Bring us into the everlasting heritage of your children, and especially with Charlie Hudson, that with all your saints, past, present, and yet to come, we may praise your name forever. Through Christ, and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. God of promise, you have prepared a banquet for us. Hallelujah. Ta hagia, tois hagiois, holy gifts for holy people. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Thank you. Let us pray. God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another, and you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. God bless you and keep you. God make God's face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. God lift up God's countenance upon you and give you peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Creator, the Reconciler, the Redeemer, be among you and remain with you always. As those who have been encountered by God in the event of faith in the proclamation of Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit, go. Go forth into the world carrying and sharing the grace and mercy of God, bringing God's love to all. Alleluia, alleluia.